that was really intense. And as a former health services researcher, and as someone who taught classes in quality of life, risk adjustment, et cetera, I was just sort of taken back down memory lane. Let me also say that this is going to be far less intense than what you just saw. And I mean that with utmost respect. I was just sitting there and I was like, oh my goodness. Okay, so that's the first thing. Second thing is when you're one of the last speakers, right, you have the advantage of seeing what everybody else does and commenting on their talks. You also have sort of that trepidation of, and we've all been talking about, those of us who've been speakers thinking, you better really bring your A game for a number of reasons. The presentations have been amazing. And ultimately, Dr. Gwande is coming, and just to give you an example of sort of where I am positioning with all of this, my wife is here, she's joining me today. I said, you're going to come to my talk? And she said, no, I'm going to go walk on the beach, but I'll be there for the book signing. So that just kind of gives you a sense of that. And so that's all my opening notes. I will say this, though. Although this is light, I think conceptually and I think thematically, it's important. And I'm going to read you just a couple things that I've noted over the last couple days, because I think they'll tie in well to what we're going to talk about today. A woman who has hand pain from chronic diabetes, who has no option but to go to the ER on a daily basis. We heard about that. A mother with an addiction problem who's on Medicaid, who is presented with a Medicaid app to try to figure out how to use. A physician who's trying to treat a patient and needs to follow guidelines in order to get pre-authorization. A newly diagnosed diabetic who works two jobs, has a husband who is cheating on her and is abusive and has a special needs son. And then finally, Medicare beneficiaries and their enrollment decisions and which way are they going to go and what are they going to do. All of this is the business of behavior change. And that's what I hope to convince you in a conceptual, with a few detail, a way that everything we've been talking about and everything we will be talking about has to do at some level with the business of behavior change. So those are my opening notes. All right. Well, there we go. Okay. You do have handouts. You have handouts because I think once an academic, always an academic, once a teacher, always a teacher. So I couldn't give you a syllabus, so this is the closest thing I could do. So you'll have those handouts and we'll talk about them. There won't be a test, however, so that's good. This is my life. And I have it up here, and I don't know whether this is a kind of a cool thing to have my entire life encapsulated up here, or kind of depressing, because this is my life. The reason I want to show this to you is my entire career has been spent in the area of behavior change. And it's been spent in various ways in the area of behavior change. And what I've come to realize is that when you're in the business of behavior change, like I am, it permeates all aspects of your life. It's not just what you're doing academically. It's not what you're just doing from a science standpoint. It's not what you're just doing from a familial standpoint. So I'm going to walk you through my life in about 30 seconds and just give you a sense of my journey and how I got from where I started to being this chief behavioral science officer for a company now. So I was born bald, but there was a period of time where I had hair, but we don't have time, so we're going to start when I didn't have hair. Undergraduate work at UCLA. I was part of what I call the happy major. So this was a psychology major with 200 to 300 people in each class. My one claim to fame there, for some of you who are old enough, I did have an abnormal psychology class with Troy Aikman. So that might resonate for some people, Troy Aikman. Yeah, okay. I also, though, at that time met a man who showed me that behavior modification principles could be used to help autistic children live almost normal lives. And that was my hook. That was enough to get me hooked into this behavioral science stuff. Went down to University of California, San Diego, and was very focused on the relationship between behavior change and chronic medical illness. But more specifically, and the next hook for me was looking at patients with chronic pain and watching how changing their behavior not only made them more functional, but reduce their pain itself, this sort of interaction between behavior and physiology. And that was enough to hook me. Along the way, met a sweet Southern woman from Kentucky, and the next thing I know, I went from Del Mar to Birmingham, Alabama, where I was in a school of public health. And here, I didn't want to become a health behavior guy, where every psychologist who goes to schools of public health is supposed to be. I went into the Department of Healthcare Organization and Policy because I wanted to figure out how do we make healthcare delivery systems in a way that correspond with what I learned about behavior change. That took me about 16, 17 years. I haven't quite figured that one out yet. Had a couple kids. Kids are wonderful for behavior modification scientific experiments. Fabulous. And I have one of each, too, which is great. Picked up a dog because you always want to have a diversified sample. And as my friend Julie Slezak would say, it's all about sample size, big data, okay? Then, this is another sort of self-deprecating, interesting moment that I wouldn't normally say. I decided to write a book. Why? Because I couldn't disseminate what I was trying to do academically in a way that I wanted to. That was number one. Number two, my mother said, how come you're not an author? And when I sent her my CV, and at the time I had about 60 publications, she said, yeah, but none of my friends have ever read any of this. Okay. Now, unlike our speaker who's coming up next, I rank about 875,000 on the Amazon ranking list. So I just want to let you know it's not quite New York Times bestseller. But another attempt to do that. Finally, pick up another dog, half-brother related to the other one, so I have a sample size of 4 to do my experiments. And then finally, about 7 years ago, find myself in a position to join a technology company where I was challenged with, could I bring my knowledge of behavioral science to a technology platform in order to change behavior at scale? All those different things, all focused in the same area, the business of behavior change. Okay. So, how many of you had Psych 101 at some point in your career? Okay, so we're gonna brush. So this is good, because what I'm gonna talk to you about today, you've had. But I wanna talk to you about it in a slightly different manner, and in a way that I hope is gonna be useful for whatever you do, but also sort of bring back some memories of some basic concepts. You get asked a lot as a psychologist, what is behavioral science? And here's a nice definition. It is an empirical approach to understanding, evaluating, and changing human behavior. That works sometimes, but if you think about what behavioral science actually is, the delay. It's the science of doing. If you think about it, if it has to do with people, and not necessarily even people, organisms, doing something, then it has to do with behavioral science. And if you think about that, as someone who talks to graduate students a lot, who are all freaked out because they're in psychology, what am I gonna do, and reimbursement rates and all those sorts of things, I said, look, if it has to do with human behavior, you've gotta stick in the game, potentially. And so a lot of what behavioral science is the science of action, is the science of doing. All right, now, the interactive exercise. Oh, I am a clinical psychologist too, licensed clinical psychologist. There will not be any group hypnosis that you know of. And yes, I'm analyzing everybody that I can see, so we'll get that out of the way. Let me ask you a question though. I wanna see if you sit there in whatever roles you're in, I wanna find out if you're fundamentally in the business of behavior change. So, by show of hands, how many of you have children? Okay, pets. Personal goals. You ever set a New Year's resolution? Yeah, that's a whole nother talk. Work in an organization where you need your coworkers, whether those are coworkers, employees, or to behave in a certain way in order for you to be effective. Work in an organization where you need your customers, clients, patients, members, individuals to behave in a certain way in order for you to be effective. Okay. Now, if you answered no to every single one of those, then my recommendation to you would be to get up right now to leave. I don't know if it's raining or not. I would suggest go outside, take a walk on the beach, go shopping, go golfing, take a tour, go have lunch, do any of those actions that you want to do, oh, but then you'd be in the business of behavior change again, wouldn't you? Because you'd be doing action. So for about the next 25 to 30 minutes, you're still stuck with me. Okay. What's the common denominator here? Because we've already rattled off 5,000 different behaviors. The common denominator is behavior. It's what links all of this together. It's what links dog training to parenting to Medicare beneficiary enrollment to pharmacy adherence. If you think about it from the lens of behavioral science, what seems incredibly disparate can be incredibly integrated. And that is powerful and important as we get to our next slide. And I don't know if you're familiar, if you're familiar with this report by Oliver Wyman, I highly, highly recommend that you check it out and that you read it. It's a quick read, it's great, there's great graphics. But what's really interesting about it is they talk about the patient to consumer revolution. But think about it for just a minute and see if this makes sense. Every patient is a consumer. Every consumer occasionally, sometimes, becomes a patient. And so this revolution that we're seeing is really something where it's the healthcare system coming into play with the rest of the world. The other thing that's important about it is as you start looking at things like the quantified self, and think about the quantified self for a minute. Right now, my phone's over there. But I can know exactly where I am. I have no sense of direction. I can know exactly where I am anywhere in the world. At the same time, I can know how many steps I took. I can know potentially what my heart rate is, how good my sleep was last night, potentially my blood sugar. And even with this cool new app I have from ADT Security, I can change the temperature in my house and watch what my dogs are doing all from my cell phone. Okay? The quantified self, it's important for us to remember, is not just the quantified physiological self. It's the quantified social self, the quantified fiscal self, I can check my bank account as well, and the quantified behavioral self. That's very important because, again, now you have all these disparate actions, and the question is, how do we pull it all together? Oops. I want you to think about the individual as the center of a universe. And the healthcare system is merely one planet in a solar system. And this is really important because as individuals, we interact with the world in various ways every day, from our banking to our food to coupons to tracking things on our cell phone. And what happens is this becomes part of our human nature. And now the healthcare system comes in and says, I want to play too in that manner. What becomes interesting is how do we blend and blur those lines appropriately and still take into account, as we've had many conversations during dinner, et cetera, take into account those actions that may have nothing to do technically with healthcare, but absolutely have to do with the individual and which end up affecting healthcare because they have to do with the individual and his or her behavior. We go back to this idea of the common denominator. It's just not going to happen for me today. Okay. Please don't count this against my time. It's really not going. Okay. So, all the transitions. Let's think of it this way. Our behavior drives outcomes. Actions drive outcomes. Outcomes define success. We need people to behave in certain ways. I gave you some examples. You have your own. We need people to behave in certain ways in order to get those outcomes. And here's the most important thing. It's the collective behavior of the population that decides the game. In healthcare, we all do this. If they don't do what we designed for them to do, then I ask you for a moment to, instead of saying what's wrong with them, to say what's wrong with what we did? What is wrong with how we designed it? Why didn't they adhere to the medication? Why didn't the group enroll in this program versus that program? This idea of collective behavior is really important for us because so often it determines the outcomes. Okay. Humans, I'm a psychologist, humans are crazy. We are crazy, crazy, crazy. But our behavior is not, there's a difference between crazy, there's a difference between irrational, crazy, and random. Human behavior is not random. If it's random, if it was completely random, I couldn't have got a degree. If it was completely random, there would be no science. Human behavior is explainable, predictable, and lawful. If you think about it on average, if you think about it in terms of probabilities, and that's what I want to show you, because of that, not only can I have a degree, but because of that, we can have an impact on human behavior, or this thing we call engagement. And if you can roll this slide, roll this video, I want to show you this. You'll love this. It's very cute. And
we're good. We're good. We're good. We're good.
I've seen that video like at least a million times. I've shown my kids a million times. I still laugh. This is a great video because it was entitled, Watch a 3-Year-Old Control 500 People, right? 500 adults. What you saw here is what we call shaping. This was a classic. I wish I had this when I taught undergraduate. We didn't have YouTube then. This was a classic example of this little child's behavior being shaped by the consequences. And the audience did a wonderful job of delivering those consequences in absolutely a perfect way. It's very cute, but it also tells us that you can shape behavior in a lawful way and in a cute way as well. Okay, so I also, because I'm a psychologist, know what you're thinking. And you're thinking two things right now. Oh dear God, how he's going to launch into every theory of behavior change. And then the other is, there is no way we're going to get out of here for lunch. So to remedy that problem, I'm going to say this. There are lots of academicians and scientists who spend their entire careers focusing on theories of behavior change, and there are lots of good ones, evidence-based. We sometimes get caught up on which one is better. There are certain ones that perform better than others, but for our purposes, these are all good, and it really becomes which is most appropriate for what you're trying to do or what you're trying to communicate. So now I'm going to make your life a lot easier. Look at that. All gone. The rest of them are gone. So we're going to focus a little bit on learning theory, just for a minute, maybe a few minutes. This is a little behavioral science comic relief. If there's any psychologists in the audience, you will think this is great. It says, watch what I can make Pavlov do. As soon as I drool, he'll smile and write in his little book. Remember Pavlov? And this is actually a little play on Pavlov and Skinner, if you remember B.F. Skinner. Okay. I feel better. Okay. So let's get into the mechanics. Now you have your handout. Look at that. Those two things tie into each other. All right, what I'm about to talk about is something that you are intimately familiar with. You brush off the cobwebs. We use it every day. But one of the things I want to emphasize is that what I see out in the marketplace is a lack of application and lack of use of the depth of the mechanics of behavior change. So I'm going to walk you through some consequences, and I'm going to walk you through this little map to show you how powerful this can be. So you look at this flower, I call it the flower, and it's a really simple idea. If you want to increase or decrease a behavior, you can do that. I'm afraid to even push, forget the laser pointer. You can increase or decrease a behavior by increasing or decreasing it, or increasing or decreasing what you put in or take away from the environment. And then you get these quadrants. I'm going to show you the quadrants. This is the quadrant that we all know. How many of you have heard of the term positive reinforcement? I almost say it in jest because everybody's heard about positive reinforcement. I go to work, I get paid. My kids get good grades, they get praise. A young child claps and is really cute, and 500 people smile and clap right after him. I complete a smoking cessation program, and I get $50 that get put into my health reimbursement account. I am adding things into the environment in order to increase the probability of the behavior happening, right? Easy, straightforward. A lot of us use this in our practice, in our parenting, etc. Let's go over to this quadrant, and here's your little cocktail tip for the day. Negative reinforcement is not the same as punishment. Psychologists can't help it. You hear it all the time. Negative reinforcement, not the same as punishment. Try that out with your friends, and they might think it's interesting, or they may not care. Negative reinforcement is removing something from the environment in order to increase the chance that a behavior happens. So think about it. I fill my prescription on time, and I use generic drugs, and my copay is waived. I remove that thing from the environment, that bad thing, that copay, to increase the chance that the behavior happens. Here's a parenting one. Little Johnny sits down at the table, and broccoli is brought to him, and he starts crying. And he's crying and crying and crying and crying, and the broccoli is removed. Next day, Johnny comes to the table, broccoli there, he starts crying and crying and crying, broccoli is removed. Third day, he sits down at the table, he sees a bowl over on the side, he starts crying, 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 and there is no broccoli there. Fourth day, he just sits down and starts crying. Well, guess what the parents have done? They have negatively reinforced his crying behavior by removing that bad thing called the broccoli. So this is the point, is that negative reinforcement sometimes can produce behaviors that you don't want, but it still can increase the behavior by removing something from the environment. Punishment, positive punishment. If you smoke, you pay a surcharge. You choose a medication that's not on your formulary, and you're gonna pay maybe four times as much. Fail to pay your taxes, guess what happens? You're assessed a penalty. That is punishment. And there are bad aspects, there are negative consequences associated with punishment. We're not gonna get into that for today, but the idea is adding something in the environment to decrease the chance of behavior happens. Negative punishment, this is one you won't hear that often, but it fits in within the quadrant, and I think it's important. If you're a physician and we use non-guideline approaches to treat your patient, authorization may not be granted. We may remove that wonderful thing called authorization in order to decrease the behavior of non-guideline adherent actions. Negative punishment, removing a good thing to decrease the probability of behavior. My house, a parenting one, my kids engage in messing around behavior. Okay? And I want to decrease messing around behavior, and I want to increase studious behavior. So in order to do that, I take out the technology bucket. And I walk around and we say, Mac Air, iPads, iPods, iPhones, and it used to be just a thing, now it's an entire bucket. And we remove a good thing, we remove lots of good things, so that non-studious behavior decreases. Removing a good thing for the non-studious behavior. So my point here is, as much as we know about positive reinforcement, we've all heard this, just this alone gives you more options on how you can approach behavior change. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, I wish that was the only way to do it, but you need more than consequences. You need a formula. You need a powerful formula, and I want to let you know today here in Hilton Head, I have found the ultimate formula for behavior change.
Okay, Benjamin, time for lunch. Benjamin. Benjamin. Time for lunch.
Oh wait, there's more. This is an actual experiment. Psychology graduate student.
Yeah, try one more time. Keep going, keep going. Beep, beep, beep. Benjamin. First time. Benjamin. Bye.
Benji.
Benjamin, come, come.
God, I wish it was easy as Gangnam Style. It's not quite. So if you flip your card over, now I'm going to take for you behavioral science and give you the difference between just having consequences and putting those consequences into context. It's called the four C's. It's really simple to remember. But again, this is how we need to think about behavior change. So four C's: behavioral cost, consequence alignment, culture, and communication. Let's talk about behavioral cost. This is behavioral cost, not fiscal cost. So what I mean by that, what is the frequency, the intensity, and the duration of the behavior? So think about showing up to the ER daily with hand pain, not showing up for a scheduled preventive screen. Exercising. Are we exercising daily? Are we exercising monthly? What intensity? Are we running? Are we jogging? Not refilling your meds. All of these sorts of things are what we call the topography of a behavior. It's incredibly important. And I'll give you a very quick example. I can give you three behaviors that occur at a one-shot deal, not always annually, but on a one-shot episodic deal, and you tell me if they're the exact same behavior. Vaccination, annual physical, and a colonoscopy. Same thing? No, I hope not. If not, then we need to talk from a psychopathology standpoint. Very different behaviors, but they actually are occurring in a one-time deal. So we need to understand what is the nature of the behavior, what's the cost of the behavior to the individual. Why is that important? Because then that flows to the next part. What are the consequences? We talked about positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, punishment, etc., but how often do we give the positive reinforcement? So if it's a new behavior, we may need to reinforce somebody every single time they do it. If it's a behavior that has higher behavioral cost, i.e. A colonoscopy versus a vaccination, maybe that colonoscopy needs to have stronger reinforcement schedule. Over time, maybe that reinforcement schedule needs to change. So the idea is understanding how what the behavior is so that you can match up the nature of the consequences. The culture, the environment, this is incredibly important. Affordable Care Act. Laws around how much we can incentivize people, prevailing views among healthcare providers about what is right and what is wrong. Employers, this is from a client, employers who say, we're not going to ever incentivize for anything because people should be doing it because it's good for them. So the whole idea that behavior, no matter how much you're trying to influence it, happens within an environmental context is incredibly important because it influences the chance that that behavior happens. Communication being the last of the four C's. It's not just about telling people what they need to do, but telling them the right thing at the right time for the right behavior. The reason that these are all important is that these are all ingredients that go in to the proverbial, what we have here, the proverbial P. And P is about probability of behavior change. And if I can leave you with just one thing today, it's this. This is not, behavior change is not binary, particularly at the population level. It's about figuring out what are the actions that we're going to take to increase the chance that we get the behavior that we want. It's all a probability game. And that's very important because it's not always a sure thing. Now, why do we need a formula like this? It helps us design our interventions. It also can help us in life, and I'm going to show you how. Number one, it can help us with kids. This says, useless parenting question number one, why did you do that? As a parent, I've asked it a million times. We need a formula for behavior change, not just asking them why they did that. Example number two, our coworkers, can't you think big quietly instead of loudly? We need a formula to help change behavior. And then finally, health. What fits your busy schedule better, exercising one hour a day or being dead 24 hours a day? We need formulas like the four C's to help us drive behavior change. Let me give you a tighter example. I'd like you to meet Sheila. Sheila is a nurse practitioner. She is 40. She has a history, family history of cancer, and she smokes. Now, in the next slide, what I want to show you is how we can take this concept of the four C's and help drive a behavior change in her. Now, without, I guess I probably don't even need to ask, but what's the one behavior that we would want her to change given what I just told you? Right, quit smoking. Okay. So we want her to quit smoking, right? Quit smoking. But if you look at it from a behavioral cost standpoint, and I know this is a little sort of behavioral science geeky, it's more than just quit smoking. This is the idea of a behavioral topography. We want her to, in this case, complete a 16-week smoking cessation program. That involves, at the very least, 16 behavioral interactions, if not a lot more. So that's one thing. We then want to line up consequences associated with that. So what can we do to help her do that? Well, maybe we give her free meds around for smoking cessation. Maybe we put dollars into a health reimbursement account. Maybe we give her verbal praise. Culture. How is the culture going to affect what she does? Well, her company happened to just switch to a consumer-directed health plan where now everything goes into health reimbursement accounts. She's also a healthcare provider where the perception is, despite the reality, as a healthcare provider, she should be healthy. Those things affect it. How do we communicate this to her? How do we let her know about these options? Well, if it's just Sheila, I can call her up on the telephone. Somebody can send her an email. You can do a mailer home. All of these things together influence the probability that she engages in the behavior. If you don't have a consequence, if there's no communication, if the culture isn't taken into account, then the chance that she engages in that behavior goes down. Does that make sense? Because it's really important. What we have a tendency to do is to focus on one of the C's. But it's the four C's together that drive that probability. Now, here's the problem we face, though. That's Sheila. What if Sheila is George? And instead of being a nurse practitioner, what if George is a 48-year-old utility company worker who's in the field all the time, is not at a computer, and stays out on jobs for months and months at a time? We may still want him to engage in the same behaviors, but we may need to shift the way we communicate. We may need to shift the way we structure the consequences, and his culture may have a bigger impact on him. Those are only two scenarios. Here's the other thing I want you to think about. What if we go from a Sheila and a George to 100,000 Sheilas and 100,000 Georges? This is probably the most important part of this. Once we shift to population-based, we have a tendency to take the science and let it just go down the tubes. And we, meaning all of us, what we do is we say, oh my gosh, it's one thing to communicate to Sheila individually, but how am I going to do that if she sits in a population? I mean, we can't even find Sheila. There she is. We can't even find Sheila. How are we going to keep good science and keep it at scale? My point is that with technology, good science can stay good science. So think about it. If we need to track behaviors for 100,000 Sheilas around smoking cessation, do we have the opportunity to do that? Well, we quite potentially do. And this is a hard slide to read. But if you think about it, could we not gather information from an EMR? Could we not gather information from the smoking cessation program that she's in as a data file? Could we not, at the very least, have her attest online about whether she's a smoker or not? If you think about pharmacy compliance, do we not have pharmacy claims that we can use? So the point is, at least on the tracking standpoint, just because we go to scale, it doesn't mean that we have to throw away this idea of understanding the behavior, influencing the behavior. That brings me to the second part. We have all these data sources. Those data sources allow us to use the different types of consequences. Maybe by Sheila completing a health reimbursement, Sheila completing a smoking cessation program, she gets a premium reduction, right? Maybe she gets dollars ported onto a health reimbursement account. We all know that all those things can be done, and they can be done at scale. If Sheila is in a different group than George, then maybe Sheila gets the health reimbursement contribution and George gets the premium reduction. Let's not forget the communication. All the data sources and the rules that we're talking about can also drive email messages, text messages, home mailers. So my point is, just because we've got to big numbers doesn't mean that we can't use the same rigor that we would use at the individual level. It's just the approach might vary slightly. And I think that is really the crux of what I see in the marketplace, is this almost paralysis by large sample size when it comes to trying to engage, and the science kind of going out the door. It doesn't need to. We as humans are at the center of this universe that is driven by information, data, and our actions. And as much as we in healthcare want to say, you know, gosh, where, what are we responsible for and what are we not responsible for? And I underscore the idea that in healthcare, we're not responsible for everything, but we also have to be okay with the understanding that those things that we're not responsible for, so we may not be responsible for what Sheila buys at the grocery store, or how she pays her bills online or not, or whether she buys cigarettes or not, or whether she takes her kids to daycare or not. We may not be responsible for that, but those are all Sheila's behaviors. And those behaviors that we're not responsible for may have an impact on the behaviors that we are responsible for. And because of technology, we now have the increasing ability to pull that information in within legal, HIPAA, cultural, et cetera, regulations, and start understanding Sheila or George or whomever as the center of a behavioral universe. That's very important because as we try to figure out why do Medicare beneficiaries choose this program versus this program, why does this woman come back to the ER every single day with hand pain, why is George not taking his medications, it may have everything to do with all of his other actions, and the more that we can understand those actions, then the more we're in a strong place to influence those actions, and we have both the technology and the science to do it. Let me leave you with this. You may or may not be a Mark Cuban fan. I apologize if you're not, but I did like the quote. It's not the dreaming, it's in the doing. Growing up, we are repeatedly told to dream big, to never stop dreaming, and to believe in our dreams. However, we are not told enough that dreams are accomplished by taking action. Dreams are merely thoughts. It's the doing which is more powerful than the dreaming. The doing is what changes the world and impacts people in unforeseen ways. We have more control over the doing than we give ourselves credit for. If you spend all your time dreaming, you will never grant yourself the opportunity to see what you're truly capable of accomplishing. This is not a dream killer speech. This is not to say we shouldn't dream. But once we dream, we need to understand how we translate that dream into actions. Actions are doing. Doing is behavior. Behavior can be tied back to a science. The behavioral science component of what I'm talking about today is just one component of a lot of things that we do, but it's a component that's often overlooked. It's overlooked in our personal lives, it's overlooked in our professional lives, and sometimes it's overlooked in our delivery system and our approaches to that. This card that you can take with you is a way, if nothing else, to remind you that when it's not working for home, for your pets, for your kids, or for your healthcare delivery system, maybe there's something in there that you didn't account for that ties back to a very powerful science. Thank you for your time this afternoon.